What's up everyone, welcome back to the channel. Thank you for joining us. If you're new here, my name is Jock. This is my 96 BMW E36 328i, which we are converting into a full-on race car. It's being built for a very specific purpose, and those details are going to be released pretty soon. I'm so excited about it. It's a massive, massive hill we need to climb to do this, but it's super exciting. It's almost like a lifelong dream we've had now. There's a few people involved, but we're going to get to that. So where are we with the build? So because of this massive thing we are working towards, there is a lot we need to do in quite a short space of time. So I've been pushing in the background. I haven't been able to film everything, but there's a lot that we have obviously filmed. So today we're going to be covering a few main things. We've done the windows, we've done the door cards, we've ordered a shift lever from a manufacturer in Cape Town. What else? We've done the chassis reinforcing in the back. So we're just going to cover all of that. So let's start off with the door cards. Templates are made up in their basic form, and it's really rough, but it gives me a basic outline. From here I need to cut it out of the plastic. Similar to what we've done with the Renault Clio. If you want to check that out, I think it's here. check it out here. But it's pretty straightforward. We made up a template and we used rib nuts, and we kind of rib nutted the door cards onto the actual door with a little cutout for the strap and the door handle. So it's a very neat finish. So what we use is we use what they call a leather grain plastic finish. It's not ABF, it's just plastic, black plastic. The reason we use the leather grain finish or a textured finish is so that it doesn't mark easily. It doesn't show the marks easily. If you use a high gloss finish, even on carbon fiber, it shows the mark quite easily. So this is relatively cheap, cost effective. Got it from Maisie's, a local supplier here in South Africa. And I think it came out pretty good. The results speak for themselves. So onto the polycarbonate windows. We did very similar to what we did on the Renault Clio, but we had quite a lot of windows to do, so it took us a little bit of time. When I say we, Johannes and myself, my brother obviously is on the camera doing a lot of the footage. And so we used the existing windows as a template, as you can see in the footage, and made up the windows pretty much straightforward. We used the jigsaw to cut it. Check it out. So what we're using for the windows is we're using rib nuts or nut certs, and we did the similar thing on the Renault Clio. So we're just going to do that, and then we slide the window in, drill a hole through the polycarb, and then the window just rests on the bolts that go through. So the nut cert gun, we just insert the nut onto here, the captive nut or the nut cert, tighten it. You can't over tighten it, otherwise it messes up the thread. I think that's all right.
That's fine.
It's good. So you can see that the windows are pretty much all in now, and we've also installed some of the trim pieces. On this side we haven't installed the seal on the end, but on the rear passenger side we have. And I'm keeping the film, protective film, on the polycarb for now so that we don't scratch the polycarb up. We'll take it off a bit later when we're ready. The rear window came out really nice. So the rear window actually came together the easiest, which is not what you'd expect, because you'd think, oh well, it's a curved piece, it's a funny shape, it's gonna be tricky. These were actually a lot more tricky. They were tricky in the sense of trying to get them in and get the seals off. That was challenging. With this, we cut the shape out based on the original windscreen and it just worked. We put it on and it folded. So we've got it in. We're also using a riv nut system into the body. We use these stainless steel button head cap screws everywhere. So they pretty much all around the perimeter. We haven't used too many. What we still need to do is we're going to take these out, take the window off, and get some of that 3M sealer. Basically, it's a window sealer, the same as what we used on the Renault. And it'll seal all around the perimeter, where in between the window and the chassis, and that'll make it watertight. So we still need to do that. We haven't got there yet, but that came out really nice. So I mentioned this briefly. These are the trim pieces, and you can see there in the light that I have had these painted gloss black. Now I've had a whole lot of trim pieces painted gloss black. So if you follow me on Instagram, you would have seen this already, but so I've changed this and a whole bunch of other pieces from chrome to black. It looks amazing. Really, really happy with how that came out. But the pièce de résistance is this grill. I changed this from chrome to black as well. Man, this thing is looking amazing. So really excited to get this on the car. This is like one of the last pieces that go on, but it's gonna look pretty cool. Here's the other side. You can see there is the black trim piece. It looks really good. And then this side has the window seal in on the driver's side. So look amazing once the covers are off. Obviously still need to get the windscreen done. That'll get done before it goes for the exhaust, because I don't want it driving down the highway with a whole bunch of air going through. But there's a lot of work to be done before that. Okay, so the rear suspension reinforcing. So what I did was we made up some card templates. And we sent that off to a local laser cutting company. They laser cut us some pieces of steel according to our templates. And I borrowed a machine from a friend and attempted to weld these templates on. Now, I can do normal welding, basic welding, on a flat surface, which I did with the spring carrier on. But the upside down welding stuff, I couldn't get it right. I tried all the different settings on the machine. I was watching videos to try and figure out what's going on. It just wouldn't happen. I managed to get hold of a guy named Stefan from RSI Projects. I found him on Facebook. He's a fabricator and he does all sorts of just all sorts of fabrication work, from trailer builds to modifications to pretty much anything steel manufacturing wise. So I asked him to come have a look. I told him about the what we're trying to do, seen the pictures, asked him to come and have a look, and he had a look at it and said, no, this is no problem. So I said, cool, bring your machine, you can use this one, it doesn't matter. He brought his own because he uses a special mixture of the gas, and he got in there and he just killed it, man. Alright, so we've had these plates made up. These were laser cut based on templates that we made up. So those are going to go get welded into the chassis underneath, and basically where the front of the rear control arm connects to. So this is one of the areas. This is where the front of the control arm connects to. So we're going to weld one of the plates in there. This is where the front of the rear subframe bolts to the chassis. And so what happens is that the material fatigues here, and then it cracks, basically cracks giant holes in through here. So we're going to reinforce this. These two sections at the back of the chassis here is for the rear of the subframe. So we're going to use the bolt and bolt in the plate and then weld it in. Okay, these have been substantially modified to fit in, so we will check how those go in now, and if we're happy, we'll weld them in. It's a little bit tight. Results are pretty amazing. He did an amazing job. It's actually really impressive what skill and just understanding of the equipment does. And the biggest challenge was A, it's upside down, B, there's contamination. So we've tried to clean it up as much as possible, but anyway, he's the expert, knocked it out the park. So I've primed it and painted, just given it a coat of paint so that it doesn't rust. And there we go, we're ready to install the rear end. All right then, someone that's helping me, Sean from PE, he referred me to a company called Triple C Shifters in Cape Town, and he made up this amazing short shifter for the E36, and it just looks amazing. It's really, really nicely finished. Let's check it out. So you can see it is a nice bulky unit. This is aluminium, machined out of aluminium. This is knurled at the top so it gives you nice grip. This is really nice thick steel. It's probably 3mm, sorry, it's probably 5mm steel. So that's a bent up piece. We've roof nutted it into the chassis. So overall, that is gonna give us a very, very nice crisp feel. A lot of the guys in PE use that already, so it is really, it's a really smart shifter. The bottom is adjustable, so you can, that allows you to adjust the throw of the actual shifter. So, and it's locally made, so super, super happy with that. Shout out to Clinton from Triple C Shifters in Cape Town. Thank you, sir. That is a quality item. All right, so that is where we are at the moment. Now, a lot of this work has been happening in the background. We didn't manage to film all of it, and that's just simply because we've got so much to do. And a lot of the time, a lot of this kind of work takes a lot of time, but we're capturing the majority of it. So where to from here? The next big thing, and it's been holding me up for a long time, is the engine. I've got the pistons, eventually found pistons. I had the block re-sleeved, and to suit the piston. Then because it was sleeved, it's cast iron sleeves. You can't use the piston rings that come for the standard block, because the standard block has got Aluseal or Nikkelsil coating on it. So that is a cast iron ring, and you can't use a cast iron ring and a cast iron sleeve. So you need a chrome ring. But to find a chrome ring for a 0.5mm oversized piston was very difficult. So I eventually contacted the importers of Hastings rings. At the same time, I ordered a set of rings from Australia, and those rings have actually arrived now. It took a long time. The Bison Systems Vanar seal kit took 3 months to get here through our postal service, so obviously never doing that again. I mean, if I order it through UPS, it gets here two and a half weeks. So anyway, the pistons are at the machine shop for clearancing. You're going to see the whole process of getting to the clearancing, etc., in another episode. I'm busy filming that. I filmed half of it already, and then the pistons have gone off. So I'm waiting for the pistons to come back. Once they do, we can check the clearances against the valves. If that's all good, the pistons will go off with the crank, the conrods, the flywheel, the front pulley, and all that for balancing. And then we'll wrap up that episode to that point. And then when I get all the stuff back, we'll build the engine, and we'll cover that in another episode. There's very specific things we have to do and check and da da da. So it's going to be very technical, but that is the next big step. I need to build the engine, bolt it to the gearbox, put it in, get the front suspension in. Still waiting for those shocks. I don't know what to say. Anyway, from there it's just bolting stuff on. We still have to do the rear end refurb. We'll do that after the stuff is in, because I can't put the rear end in because it becomes too heavy on the jack. So a lot of funny logistical challenges. Anyway, thanks for watching. Thanks for supporting us. Like I said, we've got big news coming. So excited. It's a big mountain ahead of us, but it's one of those things in your life. You have an opportunity to do it, you've got to take it. And just enjoy the ride, really. So thanks for joining us. Thanks for supporting us. See you guys later. Ciao.